Our Christian experience, in order to really be valid, has to be practical. Theories, concepts are all great if they work. It's amazing how many good theories don't work. Amazing how many things that, you know, as you looked at it, you say, wow, this is a winner, this will really go, you know, but you try to put it into practice, and there's just something lacking between the precept and between the practice. So if the Christian walk, if the Christian faith is valid, then it has to have its practical application in my everyday life. Christianity just can't be a benefit to me when I gather on Thursday evening with the body of Christ and I sing the choruses and I feel good. And I can't wait for Thursday evening to come again so I can come and feel good once more. There has to be that working out in my daily life for the experience to be a truly valid experience. So, having laid down for us certain precepts of the Christian faith, declaring what God has done for us, what we have through the work of Jesus Christ, Peter then begins to make the practical applications as to how these truths are to be worked out in our daily living. And basically, it is important that we realize that life is made up of obedience and submission to authority. And there is a chain of command. We none of us live autonomously, a law unto ourselves. You remember when Jesus was talking with the centurion who had come to him concerning the healing of his servant. Jesus said, well, I'll come to your house. He said, oh, no, Lord, it's not necessary that you come into my house. For I also am a man of authority, having under me men. Now notice, I am a man of authority. I am a man rather under authority. And I have under me men. In other words, I understand what authority is about. I understand what the chain of command is about. I am under authority, and I have under me men. And I can say to this one, go and do it, and he'll do it. And to another, come, and he comes. Now, I know that in this authority, that you have the authority to just say to my servant, be healed, and he's going to be healed. You don't have to come to my house to do it. I recognize the authority that you have. I understand what authority is all about. It is important that we do understand what authority is all about. We each of us have our sphere of authority, that which we rule over. Even if it's the dog in the backyard. And we understand what it is to have authority. As mothers, the authority over the children, the authority over the home. But we also need to recognize authority because no man can truly rule who is not ruled. In other words, the authority chain never stops with me. I'm never the top rung of the ladder of authority. And the moment I think that I am the top rung in the ladder of authority, then you have anarchy and you have an untenable situation. I am a man under authority. I understand what that's about. I have under me men. I understand what it is to take orders. I understand what it is to give orders. And God has established an orderly chain of command. And as Christians, we learn to respect authority. We learn to respect the authority of Jesus Christ in our lives. We have learned to submit to that authority of Jesus Christ in our lives. And in the degree that we submit to the authority of Jesus Christ in our lives, in that same degree, we're going to have a successful Christian life. But in those areas where I may be rebelling against the authority of Jesus Christ in my life, in that same degree, I'm going to be having problems with my Christian experience. Now, there is within the Christianity and within the whole Christian framework that premium that is placed upon submission. I must learn to submit. Now, this is really a thing that is sort of contrary to my own nature. Because my own nature would like to rule. Children begin very early to rebel against the authority of their parents. They don't want their parents telling them when they can come in at night. I don't want you to tell me what I have to eat. I want a Coke and a hamburger, and I don't want vegetables, you know. And early, a rebellion against authority begins to develop because that is a part of our own natural man. It is human nature to rebel against authority. And yet we recognize that if there is no authority, then we have an anarchy and we will soon have no society. Our whole social structure is based upon authority and the proper respect of authority and the proper administration of authority. And in any of those areas where you have a breakdown, if the person in authority is not properly administrating his authority, if he himself feels that he doesn't have to answer to anyone, then you've got a tragic situation. But if that person who is in authority recognizes the authority of God in his life and is submitted to the authority of God, then you have a great situation, a great form of government. But any government that denies God and the existence of God will exercise the authority so as to bring people unto slavery and the loss of freedom. There only is a true exercise of freedom when you have the limitations that are established and you know what those limitations are, and then you operate within the boundaries of those limitations. You can be thankful that the city council has enacted the ordinances that say that you can only drive so fast on particular streets in the city. And that when you come to a sign that says stop, you must stop. For if everybody disregarded these speed laws or the stop signs. If everybody just drove as they saw fit themselves, then our highways would be even more dangerous than they already are. You wouldn't dare go out on the highway. You say, well, I have the freedom to do whatever I want. If I want to go 100 miles an hour down Fairview, that's my right. I can do it. Yet, we have the laws that place the restrictions. You have the freedom to a point. But it is important that these points be defined. Else, you have, again, the untenable situation in which no one can live. Now, the Bible says that authority is of God. God is the one that has established authority. And he who is resisting authority is in reality resisting God, because God is a God of order. And the final authority is God. Else again, it would be impossible to live. So, because submission is a necessary part of life, and because it is opposed to my own nature, which desires to rebel against authority, one of the works of Jesus Christ in my life is that of changing my attitude towards authority, bringing me into a realization of my need to submit to authority, if that submission be to the authority especially of Jesus Christ. And that's where it all begins, is accepting Christ not as my Savior, but accepting Christ as my Lord, which means the submitting of my life to his authority. Now, this begins to work out not only in my relationship to the Lord, but in my relationship to others around me. The Bible says we should be submitting one to another in love, not always insisting on our way of doing things. But that of getting along with people, submitting to one another in love. Now, there are then within life certain relationships, the employer-employee relationship. So if you are an employee, then Peter deals with your relationship to your employer, how that you should submit unto your employer. And not just to the good, wonderful employers, but even if they're a hard taskmaster. For if they're good and wonderful and you submit to them, what are you proving? If they're paying you a decent wage and everything is going great and you submit to them, there's no real merit or value in that. Christ being our example, who submitted himself unto the Father. And when he was reviled, reviled not again. As an employee, your employer may come railing on you. Now you're not to rail back on him. You're to submit. And even if he rails on you for something you haven't done, there is where your Christian experience will really be proved. Now, if you've made a mistake and caused the company a loss of $10,000 and he comes railing on you and you bow your head and you say, oh, I'm sorry, I know I'm such a stupid thing, I'm so sorry, you know. Well, if you take that well, so what? You've cost the company $10,000. You better take it well. But if you aren't at fault, and the guy is railing on you, and it's really not your fault, and you just accept it and take it well, Peter said, then the love of God is really dwelling in you. There's some real proof that the whole gospel is beginning to work in your life. So having dealt with this employer-employee relationship and the right attitudes that we should have concerning those in authority, he takes the common order of that day as far as slaves were concerned. For he next addresses himself to the wives. And it is tragic that in the culture to which Peter was writing, the wife was only one step above the slave. As the slave, she had no rights to her own. She was her husband's property. And he could do with her what he wanted and dispose of her any time he wanted to do so. And so Peter now addresses himself to the wives, who many of them were in a very difficult situation because of the culture and the cultural practices of those days. The Greek culture, which dominated this particular period, according to Aristotle and other of the Greek philosophers, every man should have a mistress in order that he might have exciting companionship. He should have a concubine for sexual pleasures, and he should have a wife to bear his legitimate children. And that was the Greek concept of life and women in life. And into this pagan culture, the gospel of Jesus Christ came as a light. Women were almost an embarrassment. I've mentioned how that if a woman was pregnant and expecting when she is in labor, everybody would gather for a celebration, bringing everything for the party. And when the child was delivered, if it were a boy, they would have a great big party. They'd throw a bash. But if the child was a girl, then they would all go home, no party. Disappointment. And there are many cultures where this still prevails to the present day. Cultures that are not strongly influenced by the light of the gospel of Jesus Christ still hold women in a subservient level. We were visiting in New Guinea. And there in New Guinea, the men were the only ones that could worship their gods. And they had the house of worship where they worshiped their gods. And if the woman would dare to step on the property, even if she be a little girl, she's put to death. If she would dare to touch the house in which they worship God, she'd be put to death. Or a place where a house for worshiping God once existed. If the little girls in their play would run across the area that was once a sacred place, they take her down and throw her into the rapids. Women are not thought to be humans in that culture, and thus cannot worship their gods. And the guys get together in the little houses of worship, and they chew on the Beatles and get high and play their flutes, which they tell the women are their God speaking to them. And they'll go out and say, the gods have ordered barbecue pig, you know. And so the women have to go fix the barbecue pig, and they come and bring it to the men, and they go in there and eat the barbecue pig, and then the gods order the other foods, and the women are out there just waiting on the men. Suicide rate is extremely high because the woman has nothing to live for. Suicide rate among women. We were just recently in a strong Arab culture. We were visiting with a man, an Arab, who has 5 girls. His wife is expecting now. If it's not a boy, he will lose all of the respect of the community and will probably be replaced as far as his position as a leader in that community. That's the present day. The baby's due in March. He told me to pray for a boy. It's just a part of their culture. The boys are held up and honored and all, but the little girls are sort of a disgrace. At least if you bear a girl. And there are cultures where if you cannot bear your husband a boy, the same Arab culture, that they can divorce you because you can't produce a son for them. Into this dark pagan culture, the glorious light of the gospel began to shine. But the women who were living in this culture were living under indeed difficult circumstances. Because many of the women embraced Christianity. And because Christianity is such a glorious, liberating experience, from the darkness of pagan society and culture, many of the women were beginning to carry their liberty a little too far. We know that this happened in the Corinth church, where the women began to throw off the old customs of wearing veils, because after all, we're Christians now, and we don't have to wear those stupid veils and long robes and so forth. You women think you have it bad, but you ought to have lived in some of these other cultures. Be thankful you weren't born in a Bedouin home today, or tent, where the women still do all the work. Plant the fields, harvest the fields, watch the sheep, fix the food, keep the house or the tent, while the men do the more important things, like drinking coffee with each other and playing cards and discussing world situations. No wonder those Bedouin men are resisting modern culture. You go down there to try to acculturate them and you get driven out. Those guys are kill people that come down there. They have a good thing and they know it. That is good for them, but it's not good for the women. Blackness of pagan culture, darkness. Into this darkness, the gospel, the glorious light of Jesus Christ began to shine. And so Paul is writing now to some women who are really experiencing some really traumatic experiences because they've now come to the glorious knowledge of Jesus Christ. The darkness of paganism is over. They realize the glorious freedom now that I have in Christ Jesus. But with many of them, their husbands had yet not come to Jesus Christ. They were still in pagan darkness. And so she was in a very difficult situation, being freed by Jesus Christ, yet still married to this ogre who was still bound by the slavish traditions of their culture. What should be her attitude? As a Christian, how can she live in this kind of a environment? So Peter writes to them, likewise, that refers you back to the slaves with their masters, Christ our example of submission. Likewise, ye wives, be in subjection unto your own husbands. Now that grates. As I said, it's against our nature to submit. We don't like submission. We have rebelled against authority from our youth. And yet God has established a chain of authority. And it is interesting that Peter is not just writing to those who have good, godly husbands, but to those who do not as yet obey the word. Be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they also may without the word be won by the manner of life, the manner of living of their wives. Our lives are always a stronger witness than our words. One of the tragic mistakes that we have made in Christianity is thinking that witnessing for Jesus Christ is going out and sharing with someone the four spiritual laws or asking people if they're born again. That may be a form of witnessing, but true witness is not something you do, it is something you are. Your life is a witness for Jesus Christ. Paul said, hey, I don't need any letters of commendation. You are the living epistles known and read of all men. People are reading you. There are some people that really don't know anything at all about the Word of God. They're totally ignorant to what God's Word declares. As far as God's Son, Jesus Christ, coming and dying for our sins and the whole doctrine of redemption, atonement, and all, they know nothing about it. But they watch you and they see you and they see in you a quality of life that they desire. They see that there's a love, they see that there's a peace, they see that there's a joy in your life. And in this world in which we are living, there is so little true love. There is so much unrest, and so little true joy, that they long to be able to take adversity like they observe you taking adversity. They long for that joy that they see in your life. They long for that peace. And though they don't know the scriptures yet, they know that there's a quality that you possess that they don't possess and they desire. Just like the young man that came to Jesus and said, good master, what must I do to inherit this age-abiding life? Now, he's not talking about a quantity of life. He's talking about a quality of life that he observed in Jesus Christ. And there should be a quality of life that is being demonstrated by us that is the Word of God to people who don't know the Word. It's a witness to people who don't know the Word. And more people will be drawn to Jesus Christ by observing your lifestyle than will be won by your clever argumentation in the presenting of gospel truths in chapter and verse. For after all, if it doesn't affect your life in a positive way, then why should they desire it, or what value are your words? They are as empty platitudes in the ears of those who hear it, because they see no demonstration in your life. The most effective witnessing you'll ever do is just not going out and nailing people on the street, but it's having people come up to you and say, hey, you know, I've been watching you for the last 3 or 4 months, and there's something different about you. You have a joy that, I don't know, I've seen you go through some rough places too, and I know that everything's not always good, but you always have such a great attitude. What's so different about you? Hey, I'll tell you, that kind of witnessing, you don't have to push it, you don't have to pressure it. They're open, they're ready, they've seen the demonstration, they're longing for the answer. And so, wives, you may be in a bad situation. Your husband may not be a believer. And you may be going about it the wrong way to make him a believer. You may be trying to shove religion down his throat, putting little tracks in his sandwiches so when he chomps down, you know. What in the world is this, you know? And he spits it out, and here it says, repent, you know. And your endeavor to cram it or to force it only creates resentment in his own heart. But your life, that's what will be the powerful witness. So, the wives are exhorted to submission to their own husbands, so that if any of them are not obeying the word, they may, even without the word, be won by just observing your godly manner of living. While they behold your chaste or pure life that is coupled with reverence, they see that purity in you, and they see that reverence that you have for God. And it just is a witness to them. Who's adorning? Let it not be the outward adorning of the plaiting of the hair and the wearing of gold or the putting on of apparel. Now, let me say at this point that I do not believe that it is correct or good scriptural exposition to try to take this verse to prove that women should not go to the beauty parlor and have their hair done, or should not wear, you know, gold rings or necklaces or whatever. I do not think that it is a proper exposition of this scripture to prohibit fixing up and looking nice, to prohibit the wearing of jewelry, as some have interpreted it, because actually you would prohibit then the wearing of clothes, because it says putting on of apparel. And surely we're not ready to do that. what Peter is pointing out is this. You women need to recognize that there is a beauty that is far greater than the outward beauty. That the true beauty is not the outward appearance. Now, there are some women who are attempting to be beautiful. And in their attempt to be beautiful, their whole emphasis is upon the face that they are developed the capacity of painting on their selves, you know. And some women are very artistic. They can do a fantastic job. Takes a while. But, you know, who can deny that they're not tremendous artists when they're through? Now, that is a very shallow form of beauty, though. It can be washed off with the next shower. That isn't the true beauty. The true beauty is the inward beauty. That is the beauty that God looks upon. That is the beauty that is truly to be desired. In watching the Merv Griffith program or some of these talk shows, you know, they get some of these gals from Hollywood on these talk programs, and that's a mistake. Because if they don't have a script, some of them are just empty-headed duds. Scatterbrained. So vain. They just sit there the whole time looking at themselves in the monitor, primping and prissying up, you know, and their whole thing is their outward beauty, the posture and their whole outward beauty, you know, and the effect that they can try to have upon people, you know, aren't I beautiful? But you listen to their philosophies, you listen to what they say, and they're ugly. Absolutely ugly. The true beauty is not the surface beauty. Now, God may have endowed you with some marvelous, natural kind of beauty. But yet, if it isn't matched by your inner life, it's really very worthless. There's an old Swedish proverb that says, good cooking lasts, good looks don't. And by this, they seek to encourage the young Swedish boys to marry good cooks rather than good-looking gals. Because after all, the good cooking, that'll last on through the marriage. But the good looks, you know, all of us are going to get old. And to some people, growing old and lines on your face become really a disaster. That's because you've placed so much emphasis upon the outward man. But you know, that woman that walks with God, the older she gets, the more beautiful she becomes. Because the longer you walk with God, the more that inner beauty is developed. And I love being around these beautiful little old ladies down there in the convalescent hospitals and all who have really walked well. Now, there's some of them down there that are just as ugly as sin. They're foul-mouthed. They got a cigarette drooping down, you know, and the smoke curling up through. And they're just, you know, yucky. But those that have walked with the Lord, oh, as they begin to open up and share the beauty that comes forth from these lives, and you just want to hug them. They're little angels. And that's the glorious thing about being a Christian, because the beauty that God gives is a beauty that only increases as a year. It doesn't decrease with the years. It increases with the years. The true beauty. The world may place the premium on the outward beauty. But I feel very sorry for those people who have premised their whole life upon the outward appearance and the outward beauty, because aging is just disaster. So when he says you're adorning, let it not be the outward adorning of the fixing of your hair and all. It isn't the prohibition of these things. It isn't saying that you shouldn't fix your hair. It isn't a prohibition against wearing makeup. Billy Sunday used to say, any old barn looks better when it's painted. For there were certain holiness groups, you know, that the plainer you looked, the more holy you were. And that's just as much of a fallacy as anything else. Righteousness is not something either that's demonstrated on your face. You know, by your hair in a bun and no makeup and all, and oh my, aren't they spiritual? Well, my wife and I were in a restaurant one time, and we saw these ladies come in, and, you know, not a bit of makeup, and their hair was not, you know, is back and plain and all, and we couldn't figure out if they were from a Pentecostal holiness church or prostitutes who got up late. We were discussing it, trying to figure out. Like they say, you can't tell the book from its cover, you know. And the church made a terrible mistake in trying to measure spirituality again by looking spiritual. You know, let's all look spiritual now. Now, what looks spiritual? You know, we want to look very holy, we want to look very spiritual, so. But that true spirituality isn't something that you wear, it isn't something that you don't wear. It's not something that you can look, it is something that you are. It isn't the outward. Now, man, the Bible says, looks on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. God is looking beyond the surface. So the true beauty is not the outward beauty, the adornment, but the true beauty, the hidden man of the heart, which is not corruptible, which the outward beauty, of course, is. Even the ornament of a meek and a quiet spirit. Now, these are the characteristics of true beauty according to the scripture. A meek and a quiet spirit. It is interesting, as we were going through and as we are going through the Proverbs, the thing that seems to be the greatest abomination to God is the pride of man. And in the looks category, it seems that people sometimes develop the greatest pride. Or at least that's where pride is so often manifested. But God says that the thing that is really beautiful to Him is the inward beauty, the meek and the quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God a great value. God looks down, and as God is judging the beauty of a person, the beauty of a man or woman, God is looking right into our spirits, right into our hearts. What is my attitude towards myself? And as a result of my attitude towards myself, my attitude towards others. What kind of a spirit do I have? That's what God is looking at. That's what God judges. And that's what God values. And a meek and a quiet spirit, God places a great value upon that. So then Peter points out from the Old Testament the examples. For after this manner, in the old time, the holy women also who trusted in God, they adorned themselves, being in subjection unto their own husbands. Now they adorned themselves. Even as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters you are, as long as you do well, and are not afraid with any amazement or trembling. Now, Sarah evidently was physically a beautiful woman. For when she was in her 70s, and Abraham had gone down to Egypt, he said, hey, look, say you're my sister, because you're so beautiful. These guys will say, wow, what a beautiful chick, and they'll kill me and take you. So say you're my sister so they won't, you know, hurt me and take you. Now that's quite a, you know, that's saying quite a bit for her beauty when she's 70 years old. And it happened, you know. They said, wow, look at that. and the you know, the king, her beauty was brought to his attention. And yet she is used as an example of beauty, not for the physical, but for the attitude towards her husband, calling him Lord. Now, does that mean that a wife has no say-so in the home? That she has to become a doormat? That she has this crude, crass beast living with her as her husband, making all kinds of stupid and unreasonable demands upon her, and she has to answer, yes, my lord, and has no say of her own? I read concerning Sarah, who is used as the classic example for you ladies, where she came to Abraham and said, get rid of that bondwoman or that and that kid. I can't stand them any longer. And Abraham didn't want to. But the Lord spoke to Abraham and he said, hearken unto the voice of Sarah. So, you see, the Bible is not advocating a slave-master relationship in marriage, and it should never be that. Again, even as the women are to be in subjection unto their own husbands, the husband is to be in subjection unto the Lord. But he is also to love his wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. And there is the balance. And to demand one without the other is going to create an untenable situation. Now, sometimes we really enjoy sermons that don't hit us. So I would judge that the fellows tonight enjoying the message. As Peter tells the duties of the wife. But wives, it is your duty to get your husbands out here next week to get the other side of the coin as we deal with the husband's relationship. I'm reminded of an evangelist that was holding a meeting in Chicago. And it had been quite a successful meeting. Many people had come. And on a Saturday evening, they were having sort of testimonies. The people were sharing of what the meeting had meant to them in their own lives and the blessings that they had received. And this one lady stood up and began to tell of how much the meetings meant to her and how her own relationship with the Lord was just so enriched as a result of these meetings. She had learned so much about the Lord and had so many new insights into his word. And so as she started to sit down, the evangelist said, "Ma'am, would you mind just standing there for a moment? I'd like to ask you a few questions." He said, "Now, you talk about the blessings that you have received during these meetings, but really, have they been transferred into your daily experience? Has it made you a better wife? Has it made you more loving to your husband? Has it caused you to have a better attitude towards him sweetened up the home and all?" And he started to question her like this, and he felt a tug on his coat, and the pastor behind him said, "Press those points, brother, that's my wife." So sometimes we like it when the other person's getting it. But there's always the balance. The Bible teaches a well-balanced life. And that's the thing I like about the Bible. It doesn't teach a one-sided experience or an unbalanced life. And anybody who interprets the Bible as leading them into something weird or unbalanced have misinterpreted the Bible, because it probably leads to about the most well-balanced experience of life that one could possibly have. And there's a beautiful balance that the Bible teaches in relationship, in the home, as we look at God's order. Now, it is interesting to me that the Bible, in dealing with the subject of marriage, really has only two basic rules. Rather than a long list, it gives you just two basic rules. Because God knows that we're so prone to forgetfulness, he just gives us two rules. And one is for the wife and one is for the husband. So you only have one rule to remember, the one that applies to you. And the rule for the wife is that of submission to the husband. And the rule for the husband is to love the wife, his wife, as the Lord loved the church and gave himself for it. That's a simple rule. Just one rule. Just love your wife as much as Jesus loves his church. It's the only rule you have in marriage, fellas. Simple, isn't it? Oh, no. Far from simple. But that's the rule. And any marriage that will follow the rules that God has set is going to be a beautiful, happy, glorious marriage. But which came first, the chicken or the egg? The husband loving the wife or the wife submitting to the husband? Well, those are the issues we'll get into next week as we deal with the husbands and their responsibility in this whole marital relationship. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you for your word. And Lord, we pray that you will help us, that we will be doers of the word and not hearers only, living in a world of self-deception. Lord, may we look at this, these practical injunctions, and help us, Lord, to realize the true beauty of life is never in the outward adornment, but in that inner beauty of your Holy Spirit working in us as he conforms us into the image of Jesus Christ. Oh, Lord, how we desire to look beautiful in your eyes. So work in us, Lord, conforming us into thy image. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we stand? And may the Lord be with you and bless you and apply his word to our hearts and to our lives as we go. And may God work in you his beautiful work of grace and love, giving to you those characteristics and quality of true beauty in the eyes of the Lord. God bless you and enrich you in all things in Christ Jesus. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee, and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. With his spirit and his life, let him fill.
and you